This is a lecture on what is called LU factorization of a matrix. And for this, for the beginning of this, let's assume that A is an M by N matrix and that it can be reduced to an echelon form without any row interchanges, that is swapping two rows. Now, obviously, that is a kind of limiting assumption, but that's the way that we will start this discussion. And then later on in the discussion, we will reduce that and just say that A can be reduced to an echelon form. So with that assumption, it will turn out that A can always be written as L times U, where L is an M by M lower triangular matrix with ones on the main diagonal, and U is the echelon form of A. All right, so why do we care about factoring a matrix into an upper triangular and a lower triangular matrix? Well, it turns out that if A is equal to a lower triangular matrix times an upper triangular matrix, and we needed to solve AX equal to B, then I could substitute L times U in for A, and I could write it as L times UX is equal to B. And if I make the substitution of letting y equal u times x, then I can rewrite the system of equations ax equal to b as a system of equations. Ly is equal to b, and l and ux is equal to y. This is a systems of equations where both L and U are triangular matrices, which means they have lots of zeros, and L has got ones in all of the pivot positions, and so it makes things a lot easier to end up solving. So let's look at an example and see how much easier this would end up being. Here's a 4x4 matrix A, and if I want to solve AX equal to B, then we could take for a moment, we could imagine how much computation it would take in order to solve that. What we're going to use is the fact that this matrix A can be reduced into this matrix L and this matrix U. Now, how I reduce that, we will talk about that later, but right now you should verify that if you take this matrix L and this matrix U and multiply them together, you will get the matrix A. So I'd like to solve AX equal to B by using the lower and upper triangular matrices shown here. So we start with the augmented matrix that has the lower triangular matrix L with the column B attached to it. And what I want to do is put this into reduced row echelon form. So as we all know, I'm going to take this value of 1 and I want to get zeros below that. So I need to set up the row operations that would do that, which here are the row operations. 1 times row 1 plus row 2 is the new row 2, and so on. But what I want you to notice is that since this is lower triangular, the rest of the first row are all zeros, so I do not need to do the row operations that on these columns. I also know that my row operations are set up to make all of these entries zeros, so I don't need to do those computations. The only real computation that I need to do is to take these row operations here and do those row operations on this last column. So when I do the row operation 1 times row 1 plus row 2, I'm taking 1 times negative 9 and adding it to 5. That's the only thing that it takes to do that first row operation. So the result that I get is going to have zeros below the 1, and the last column is going to be changed, but these three columns in the middle here have not changed at all. As a result, I've only done 3 additions and 3 multiplications, so I've only done 6 floating point operations. Then we move on to the next step. I want to use this value of 1 in order to make zeros below that. I know that those entries will end up being 0. Since these two entries are 0, I don't need to do any of the computation on those two columns. I only need to do the row operations on this last column. So my row operations would be 5 times row 2 plus row 3 and negative 8 row 2 plus row 4. That's going to give me this result. And since I only did the row operations on the last column, I've only done 2 additions and 2 multiplications, which is 4 floating point operations. Moving on, now I want to use this value of 1 in order to make this entry be a 0, and that would require the row operation negative 3 row 3 plus row 4 is the new row 4. I'm only doing that on the last column, and so I end up with this, and I have only done 1 addition and 1 multiplication, so I've only done 2 floating point operations. Now, going back to where we were, I have now solved for the vector y. So this is the value, or this is the vector that is the value of y, and then I'm going to use that in order to find the vector x, which was the original solution. So I've got y is equal to negative 9, negative 4, 5, and 1. And then I want to solve u, x equal to y. So I take my matrix u, and I have attached the column y. And then we look at what row operations would need to be done. Obviously, I'm going to end up doing the row operations in the reverse order. These entries are not ones, so I'm going to turn that into a one. That's what this first row operation is going to do. Then I'm going to use this one to get zeros above it. And just like before, all of these entries are zeros, so it's not going to change any of this information. I'm only doing that row operation on this last column to see what ends up happening. And so that's what all of these row operations are going to end up doing. So if I do all four of those row operations, then I have got this. Again, first three columns didn't change. Last column did change. And I have done a grand total of three additions and four multiplications. That extra multiplication was from this very first row operation. So I have done seven floating point operations. Now I'm going to move over to the second, to the third column, and put that into the correct form. I need to make this entry a one, so I'm gonna start by doing negative one, row three is the new row three, and then the row operations that would be required to get zeros above that, same thing, that is not going to affect the first two columns, it will affect these two entries, and so the result that I get is here. I have done, in that set, I only did five floating point operations, then I move on to the next, create a 1 here and a 0 above it. That is going to give me this result, which I have done only 3 floating point operations. And then the last operation would be to do 1/3 row 1 is the new row 1, which gives me only one more floating point operation. Now this column right here is the solution to AX equal to B, which was our original goal. Again, that seemed like a lot of work, but why we did this is because I did a grand total of 28 floating point operations. As we keep track as we're going along, I did 28 floating point operations. If you tried to solve AX equal to B by putting A and attaching B and putting it into reduced row echelon form, that would take 62 floating point operations. So if I can get it into an LU factorization, it only requires 45% of the floating point operations in order to solve that system of equations. If we can take any kind of a computation and reduce the amount of computation down to 45% of the original, that is a very, very valuable thing. So what I've done here is explain why I'm interested in LU factorizations. In the next video, we're going to talk about how do you do an LU factorization? How do you take a matrix and turn it into a lower triangular matrix and an upper triangular matrix?